All right. Thank you for coming here at that early morning. I'd like to thank the organizing committee for inviting me here. It's a real pleasure. I would like you to imagine yourselves in, say, after millennium, someplace in Middle East, and you just heard about it, that there is a riot in some place. And you're equivocating whether to decide or not to decide. You know that if you decide, something good is going to come out of it, and you think that what are the rights and things that you're going to get is going to be benefiting you. But if you go over there, and if you are a few, then you're going to be penalized severely, so there's a risk involved in this. On the other hand, if you do not go there, and your friends go, and if they get the benefit, it will be a free rider for you. You may be ashamed of it. So this is pretty much the story about the collective actions. So there are two ways of looking at this. There are a zillion number of beautiful works analyzing the data about the Tahrir in Egypt and also Charlie Hebdo demonstration in Paris. But I'm not going to look at the data. But I'd like to develop a simple thought experiment, and I'd like to go ahead and discuss those things with you. You know what I'm going to do. I'm going to start with the square lattices. So in order for me to be able to speak of the square lattices, so I pick up this 9,000 years ago, a small establishment, municipality, village, what you say, in Çatalhöyük. This is one of the earliest establishments. The other concurrent one is in Jordan. What is interesting here, in addition to a replica of the almost square lattices, the people had not invented the streets yet. So in order to be able to get their homes, they are going to use their roofs onto this. So they must be really acquainted with each other. I don't want to call acquaintance, rather I'd like to call them friends. So if I am going to make some decisions here, most probably I'm going to be affected by surroundings there. If time permits, or in other discussions, we can talk about the other interesting properties of the Çatalhöyük. So here is a simple setting. What we have is square lattice, and what we have Bernoulli numbers placed in here, either green or red. Probability is 1 over 2, and we're going to see that 1 over 2 is exactly the critical point. Green, just for the sake of it, go or not to go. We're going to introduce some equivocating agents later, and also we're going to introduce some stubborn agents. Once they decide, they're not going to change their opinions. But right now, we don't have any stubborn agents. And if any agent here in the lattice is going to look at and make a decision, it's going to look at the surrounding, and this surrounding I'm going to refer to as W neighborhood, and N is the number of, or N by N, the lattice size, and whatever the W that I'm going to pick up, it's going to be always much smaller than N. So when I'm doing the simulation, I'm going to be able to talk about large W's, but at the same time, large N's. So you may think about some sort of a limit there. And right now, we are talking about the perfect information. Hopefully, we're going to have some time to talk about also not-so-perfect information case. And the decision, so what I am doing, I'm going to and my around is, I'm going to pick up, in some cases, the Moore neighborhood, they call it. In some other cases, the von Neumann neighborhood. And most of the time when we do the analysis, we always almost confine our attention to the W is equal to 1, but we're going to use those things a little bit more liberally, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And in addition to that, in the first part, I'm going to use confine my attention to the Moore neighborhood, but then we're going to also discuss the von Neumann neighborhood. So here is a simple understanding of the majority rule. But I'm the green one here, and I am now using the Moore neighborhood, and W is equal to 1. And I am counting how many greens do I have, 3, how many reds do I have, 5. So 3 out of 8 is mine, but my majority is 1 over 2. Another way of saying this is, if I am the green, and if this is my number of neighbors, say I have 8 neighbors here, and if not 50% of them are not green, then I'm not happy. So you may call this thing some sort of a utility or happiness index. If I am not happy, it is zero. If I am happy, it is one. So it is like discrete now. Obviously, we have some other ways of introducing those utility functions, but right now it's a simple one. So what happens, we are adapting the global dynamics, so the global model. If I am green, and if my neighborhoods are red, in the next time step, I am switching to red. So this is like, I'd like to be in conformity with my neighbors. If I am not in conformity with them, I am switching it. So then the question is, if everyone does that, what type of states, what type of observations, what type of patterns we expect from this? So why don't you look at the one on the left? The one on the left is for the simulation, W is equal to 1. So I'm only just looking at my eight neighborhoods. In the second one on the right, W is equal to 2. So I am looking at my 5 by 5, 25 guys in order to be able to decide. So as you can see, as the neighborhood largens, the coarsening process becomes a little bit more severe. So you see that this is still 50-50 on the average of 100 simulations. But right now, if you focus on this square lattice here, you see that as time goes by, it only piece of small piece of red becomes, if I look at here, it becomes almost red, some percentage. So then we may ask the question, we may ask a zillion number of questions, but the very first one that I like to ask, this is like 1, 2, 3. Then you may ask the question, what happens when W goes to very large cases? Are we going to have all or none? Or are we going to have some other types of states? That these are the things that in the next 5 minutes I'm going to discuss. So this is the analysis of what is the probability of finding a monochromatic square with a given size. So, okay, one more time. There are two things happening here. One, the coarsening process is taking place here. So I am watching the coarsening process. The agents are looking at their neighborhoods and they are making their, updating their decisions. And the second thing, I am observing them with a window, and that window size may vary. It's up to me. The neighborhood, once I fix, the agents decide. The other one, exactly, I am looking at it. So this means that here is the... Oops, I'm sorry. Yeah, sure.
You always get some stationary states?
Ah, yeah, very good question. The states, the simulation ends when the state reaches equilibrium. So reaching the equilibrium means, or stationary state means, there will be no other person makes other decisions. There will be no more incentive to make, to alter their decisions. So everyone is happy, so to speak. So the simulation ends when these are the stationary states. So then we are, I'm sorry about that. I thought it was just inevitable. So this means that as W increases, the stationary states becoming a little bit more coarsened. Then the question is, am I going to have all green or all red states? Or smooth surfaces, striped surfaces, am I going to be able to have them? Yes, and then the proofs of those things are becoming real recently proofs, so to speak. This is, for instance, Bob Kleinberg's in Cornell, and they say that if they fix the neighborhood size, take the number of agents sufficiently large, and take epsilon. Epsilon is important here because it is exactly right before the phase transition. So 1 over 2 is the threshold. This is agents are deciding 1 over 2 minus epsilon. So our simulation is exactly at the transition. But the theorem here, it says that, oops, I am always mixing with this. Yeah, theorem says that the expected value of this probability is always less, this is a very strict bound, by the way. I can always find a constant, which is, I can reverse the sign, another C constant. So this goes like, this means that this probability is non-zero. The size of W, any W is possible, monochromatic W is possible. It doesn't matter how small or how large it is, but the important part is This is, by the way, this proof depends on the percolation theory and analytical continuation of this. The two fields medal are awarded in this, Vanden and Werner in 2006 and Simonov 2010. So it is, for me, it is definitely hard to follow them, but at least I am appreciating the results. The result says, if epsilon is zero, this is not valid. So when the epsilon is zero, we can only say that there is, this is log-log plot. There is a tendency to find monochromatic sizes, how large they are, but there is a sharp, since this is a log curve, it goes like a power law at the beginning, but then there's a sharp polynomial, some cases exponential decrease. So this means that as the observation areas becomes larger and larger, it is less probable, and finally getting zero, to find monochromatic cases. Then the next thing is, till reaching the stationary point, would that how the coarsening process evolve? If I am an unhappy person and if I'm changing it, while the number of unhappy people gets reduced, and what is the rate of that? Would there be a more universal rule of this coarsening process? So again, these are, by the way, when I'm talking about different neighborhood, and there are also different simulations over there. They are not different simulations, but different sizes. So N here, number of agents are still very large, 120, 250, 360, with compared to that. But we see that both in this case, and also the finding a monochromatic probability, and also finding the unhappy agents, those numbers are independent of the sizes. Once you fix the size, and if W over N is small enough, you are getting some sort of a universality. And as W gets higher and higher, that becomes, this is the Zipf's law, by the way. So the exponent of this is minus one, or if you count it, one. So as W gets larger in the medial part, this becomes Zipf's law, but this is at the beginning, but when it's coming to end, it becomes real faster. So it's a very slow coarsening process, but at the end becomes exponential. And this is our endeavor of, we started with a simple thought experiment. Square lattices with any neighborhood, and the agents are changing their opinion. So I should be able to develop some sort of a fractional or focal Planck type of a diffusion equation in order to be able to describe what will be the probability of observing monochromatic sizes at a given time. So it is like on the left, the vertical axis, we have a size, we pick up 10 by 10. And these are the different W's. We see that being able to find that probability becomes real fast, goes like this. By the way, this is, as you may expect, the exponent here is 1 over 2. It's like a reaction diffusion type of stuff, but this is a little bit, depending on the equilibration time, you may compare with this thing. You may compare this thing with the diffusion equation. So we are then thinking of, whether there is a universal relationship between those things. Obviously, we can make some matches here or curve fittings. So this thing looks like a very low order parabolic stuff, or high order, depend on x to the plus 4 type of thing. And unfortunately, we couldn't develop an analytical solution for the so-called thermodynamic limit. But we can see that this becomes real fast as it's slower, and then immediately become faster. And seemingly for this, and also as W gets higher, we can anticipate that we can find some exponent here that really fits almost all W's higher than some critical W, but we are in the search of that. So the other question here is, what happens if I am a little bit more relaxed? Suppose in the first case, My threshold was 50%. This means that I was really unhappy if I am green and if I have less than 4 greens around myself. What would happen if I am really happy if I have 3 greens only or 2 greens? So this means that my intolerance becomes large or my tolerance increased. So this is the red curve. This is 1 over 4. This means that in order to, for me to be able to participate in an activity or participate or to be in conformity with my neighbors, all I require is 25% of my kind of people. The purple one here, 1 over 8, yeah, 12.5% of my kind of people. So what happens here, this I can prove mathematically that if this number is strictly less than 1 over 4, all agents stay same. So the initial point is a fixed point. So if you can arrange in a configuration where agents are their thresholds are less than 1 over 4, the initial configuration stays like this. Or you can immediately switch to the configuration that is providing that. But what happens, as you expected, this is the initial color. You can pick up red, for instance. This is the final color of the red. So this is the static. And this is a little bit higher than 1 over 4, so this is like 1 over 4 plus epsilon. And if you're becoming 1 over 2, then you can see that the initial configuration, the initial ratio becomes really important, and you can see the transition here is 1 over 2. And if you increase the neighborhood, so this means that if you were to decide on your decision based upon larger and consulting more and more people around yourself, then your initial configuration becomes, initial ratio becomes very important because if you are a little bit higher than 1 over 2, then you may capture immediately everything. So then this suggests that some sort of, a quick phase diagram. In order to be able to appreciate the phase diagram, we may switch the thing a little bit. So this is like threshold of the green color is 50%. So it is like the opposite view, if you like. Threshold of the red, depend on, it, I can vary this thing here. So this is like 50% or less. And then I may look at my nearest neighbors or a little bit my regional neighbors, so to speak. Then what happens, if I lower my threshold a bit, then I gain more and more space. I get more and more people in agreement with me. So it is like, this means that if you are really more tolerable to the others, and even though if you have the same configurations, depending on those configurations we can look at here, you can gain the majority. First of all, we may think that this is like counterintuitive. How can I gain more people in agreement with me if I reduce my threshold? But if you look at the other way around, the other people are a little bit more obstinate because they are 50% threshold, so they are not switching, but you're exactly switching to the others, so this is obvious. We may talk about the phase diagram if the time permits. Now, I am going to look at some other stationary states. Now I was really dealing with the majority, but I understand what happens if I am asking for the majority. The states become stationary, little getting more the stripe states, definitely segregated, you may call it polarized, all or none. So if in that, the before Christ 9000 year, if they all decide to go north, some people are saying that no, they're going to stay here, then some people they're going to move in with the other places in the north. Then they're going to immediately segregate in their families. And then there's no room for deliberation. They cannot deliberate because there are no other opposite view. So this means that people may decide on some other stages in that they will be also, they would choose to pick up their thresholds in a little bit of different fashion, rather not only giving a lower bound, but also giving some sort of an upper bound. So this guy, for instance, is really not happy if at least 25% of the live people are on, but she is definitely unhappy if more than 50 people are also same like. So obviously you can play with this, and we play with that and try to find the universal law. But the important part here is, like, so you mentioned the stripe state. We can immediately get the stripe state. So this is another interesting thing that we can put an analytical view on this. There is 1 over 4 and 1 over 2, and this thing is a specific case where we observe this sort of a maze type of structure. And when you increase your neighborhood size, then this thing becomes all of a sudden zooming into this, humor zooming in, and zooming in, and you're more zoomed in places, then you can immediately see that if you look at all to be able to decide, then either it's going to be green or red. So this thing was a simple exercise because our objective was to appreciate what would really happen. What would really happen if all people are not informed perfectly at once? Because most of the time, this is not the case. Most of the time, only one, for instance, may know what's going to happen in their surrounding. And first, I am going to inform my neighborhood. Not come to that yet. Frustrated part is yet to come. Right now, no one can get frustrated because they have no knowledge about what is happening. Only I know, and you're my friend, I'm informing you. Then you're going to decide whether to go or not, and depending on your neighbors, then you may get in there. But right now, all I am going to do is, finally I'm going to learn how to use this. All I am going to do now, I am going to inform my neighbors. But right now, in order to be able to, you see, obviously we all know that I talk about antiferromagnetism, Ising model, and that type of analogies in the first case, obvious. And zero temperature solutions, and the proofs are still yet to come. So, but right now, my analogy is definitely with the percolation theory. So in order to be able to set the percolation theory straight, what I am doing right now, this is, by the way, very nice. His PhD thesis, this work is PhD thesis, and a little bit before 2013, now he's in the Yale University Complex Network Center. What Campbell did, he said that he's going to define two types of people right now. One, the circles, one, the crosses. But what do you mean by circles and crosses? What happens here, suppose that this is in the lattice, and I put uniformly distributed numbers between 0 and 1. And I attributed each node one number. And then I said that these are their capacities, or their money to be able to buy a product. But then, how this guy is going to be able to understand whether he is going to buy the product or not, because right after I set a price, the capacity for each guy, then I'm going to exogenously set a price. So, for instance, if this probability, this guy's capacity is 0.3, this guy's 0.4, this guy's is 0.5, and if the price of the product, if the price of the product is, for instance, 0, then all can buy. So this means that the crosses are not being able to buy, and the vice are, definitely they are going to buy. But in order to be able to decide whether they're going to buy or not, first they need to be informed. So at the time t is equal to 0, I know it, I am informing my neighbors, and since their capacity are higher than the price, they can buy. So you can imagine that. As time goes, you can immediately see sort of graphs that we saw in the morning. So this is like, von Neumann neighborhood, W is equal to 1, two-dimensional lattice, and you can immediately see that this is exactly with the bound percolation. So here are the fraction of the nodes, and here are the fraction of the adapters, and this is the ring lattice. As for the going to social networks, we know that the things are not really patterned, but we have definitely some long-range contacts. We are all familiar with the small word network, and for those, I apologize for the time concern, I may give you an impression of the small word and explain it to you in detail, but right now, all I can say that there are two variables here. One is the clustering coefficient, the other one is the average path length. And this is the perfect order. This is the random. So at each time step, I am exactly breaking one order node and making it random. So this is like the rewiring of the nodes. So this is the random network. This is the perfect order. So what happens, as soon as I introduce the randomness, the average path length reduces, but the clustering coefficient, the probability of finding, if I have three neighbors and they are all neighbor to each other, is the probability one. The lower than that is the clustering coefficient. So what happens then, when we understand what would happen if the fraction of adapters and the fraction of the potential nodes, this is like the random network, and this is like the ring lattice again. So the thing is a little bit interesting, because what we think that the small world's clustering coefficient, the cluster parts, it may help the percolation, but it's exactly the opposite. If you have the strongly knit neighbors, the being able to propagate this thing faster, dramatically delimited. So in order to be able to have the higher percolating giant clusters, you'd like to have loosely knit structures. So this is exactly stating that. Then my next thing, I hope I have two more minutes. Now I'm going to introduce some stubborn agents. So what is happening here, I have circlers. They are willing to go if they have enough neighbor that they are also stating they are going. On the other hand, the crosses, they are not going, and no way whatever they are going to change their mind. So here is the, by the way, this is the scheme that I put in the abstract. Here is the initial propagator. Again, it at times goes, it informs them. So we have the giant cluster here. Now it reaches the boundary, and then it is like solving a backward Kolmogorov type of equation, and we're solving that. And at the end, this is, even though all the greens are perfectly capable to go, they are willing to, but because their neighbors are not attending, at the end this becomes real small. So the idea is, obviously this depends on the initial condition, this depends on the boundary conditions, but the important part here is, the take-home message is the following. In order to be able to inform the people, you would like to have a loosely knit structure. You would like to have a size of the giant cluster high. But in order to be able to collectively attend the riot demonstration or whatever, you would like to have tightly knit structure. So this suggests that. This exactly says that. You have the random part, but the collective acting part, people are a little less. If you have the small world or ring lattice, these are the highly clustered parts, and the more of the collective action over the giant clusters increases. I have one more minute, hopefully, because you said the frustration, and I need to talk about that. This is everything after the stationary state takes place. What happens kinetically? Suppose someone asking you, are you going to be able to do that? Are you going to nominate this? Are you going to attend this? And you're going to say that, hold you, I'm going to go back to you, but why don't I ask neighbors? Then you're asking your neighbors, and they're also saying to you. And you're saying that you don't have a time. If we're all going to decide until 2 o'clock in the evening, this is an equilibrium, and we can do that. But otherwise, I have to anticipate. So what is happening here, for instance? This guy informs and says, okay, this other one says, okay, let me ask my friend. This guy informs, let me ask him. But all of a sudden, this says, okay, now this is the time. Unfortunately, we don't have enough time to cover all the people. The covering time is less. So what's going to happen? They are going to anticipate whether they are going to attend or not. And this problem is referred to as the coordination problem. And the coordination problem is a very interesting part. This is one of the eminent sociologists published this thing here. During the break, or others, we can go through with this if you like. Even though the thresholds of those guys are the same, this, because of this thing, those go, and this thing, the other go. One very last thing. I may not anticipate what is happening. I may ask my friend, what do you think if others are going? I am not asking you, for instance, whether you're going to go, but I am asking you, do you think that they are going? And then the network structure is very important here, because if there is a perfect asymmetry, you see this guy has high number of contacts with the others, so power law type of network, and then all of a sudden this thing, so-called majority illusion, takes place. And majority illusion first published in 2015 summer and become really an issue in the Washington Post. And these are all my graduate students are involved in this and others that in 30 minutes I'd like to share with you. Thank you for your attention. Ama öğrendim bunu kullanmasını. Yapmayın, iki soru olsaydı. İki soru, bakın ne güzel, çok.
It looks like your epidemic model. Huh? Is it true that...
You see, all those innovation propagation, disease spreading and all those things are percolating models.
Yes.
However, epidemics is only being able to predict what will be the infected people at the end.
Yes.
This is a part of the problem, because what you're happening here, you're somewhat informing or influencing or making sick to other people. Okay. But right now what is happening, I am asking you whether you're going to sign the petition. Then you're saying, I may, but let me ask my friends. Then your friends also doing that. So the first wave, so to speak, is being informed way. And then the second stage is being able to decide what to do. So it's like you're looking forward, creating a percolative analysis. Afterwards, depending on the free boundary, periodic boundary, you're back solving the equation. And depending on that, the size of this thing must be less than all those informed.
What is your critical point? Because I mean, just is it inflection point or
depending on the network size, the critical point for the epidemic spreading or innovation spreading is, if it's a power law network, it is 1/k. If it is a square lattice, it's a bound percolation, it is 0.59. If it is the neighborhood percolation, it is some other number. So we have some critical percolating points depend on the type of the network.
Okay, like a gel point, okay.
Yeah. But the problem is different.
Can you track those election results on your teams?
That thing is a little bit different, so-called the voters model, and not depend on the majority, but the proportionality rule. However, there is a little parallelism of this I'd like to discuss with you.
Is this related to cellular automata?
Obviously. Obviously related. So I wouldn't hold it, but this is something like you may want to generalize, like this is the 100th year of Thompson, growth and function, Turing, morphogenesis, cellular automata, they are exactly on the same ballgame. The important part here is, what are your initial conditions? What, how many states you like define? What are your machines rule? And then would you be able to describe the patterns without doing the simulations by giving out those conditions? You may connect this thing to Conway's game of life, if you like, also. So give me a set of rules, give me some initial conditions, give me the lattices, then am I going to be able, or give me the threshold of the people, am I going to be able to give you the patterns? What type of patterns? Stripe states or some other Bengal tiger type of states, or all the same color? So they are all the same problem. Important part here, whether we're doing this thing with the noise, meaning high temperature, or we're doing this thing with the zero temperature case. All we discuss here is zero temperature case. Well before the theoretical temperature. Yeah, çok özür dilerim.